Good morning. I'm celebrating your being here, but I think even more so, we're just celebrating being awake and on time, aren't we? We have a great joy this morning that we made it through. And God is going to be blessed with our presence, but I think even more so, we'll be blessed with His presence today. Joe, I know you're not busy right now. Yeah? Pastor's calling you out. I need you to light a candle for me. Can you work that? I'll help you. You're doing good with that. Yep. There we go. That right there. Thank you so much. Come here. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your nearness every time we come in your name. And we're grateful for the ways that you don't come empty-handed, but you come with love, grace, and blessing for each of us. May we bring to you now our worship. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Stand and sing.
You live, you died, you said in
with the praise team that we have and the way that they bring us into that spirit of worship with our music. We're so grateful for that. I want to take a moment and just mention a couple of things to you that are real important for us in the life of the church. In your bulletin, I hope this morning, you saw one of these. And I just want to share with you a personal testimony for a moment here. Last year, I bought some of these casseroles that were being sold by our UMW. It was an awesome thing. These are not just thrown together casseroles. They're great. And they were easy to eat and enjoy and to share with family and friends. So I just want to ask you, if you could, just give some thought and prayer about this. But our UMW is doing this as a fundraiser again this year. And the timing is perfect, because if it all goes well and you place your order now, you give it to them in advance and let them know what you want, they have some options here for you as far as the choices you have. And one or more would be great. Those will be available for pickup on Palm Sunday. Now, you can't get any better than that. Going into Holy Week and into Easter with these wonderful casseroles that are put together for you. So I just want to highlight that for you as another opportunity to support the ministries of our church. Our UMW is a mainstay in the life of our church. I'm taking that home. I got to remember to get permission. It's one of those things where what you're doing for them actually goes further than that. It goes into a lot of things that our UMW does in the life and ministry of our church. There are other announcements there in your bulletin, things that happen in the weeks that we go through. I want to highlight for you, and especially for this group, Wednesday nights we have a wonderful dinner here at the church. It's a time of great fellowship and a time of great connection. It starts at 6 o'clock, and by 7 we're done. Of course, our music teams are rehearsing on Wednesday nights. Sometimes there's other options for us as well. But if you just want to have a great meal, good home-cooked meal, and visit with some folks, Wednesday nights is another great time to join us, and I hope you'll think about that. And I want to take a moment now for our children also and see if our children would like to spend a little time with me this morning. And we might have a children's treasure chest here somewhere to come and experience together. Okay. Isn't it good to have these children with us this morning? This is awesome. And y'all went last week and had some kind of fun activity together. It was great to see y'all here last week too. We're going to see. This is the treasure chest. The children take it home, put something in it, bring it back. I don't know what's in here. A lot of us don't know what's in here. And we're agreeing it wasn't alive, so we're okay. And it's something good for church. So let's see what we have today in our treasure chests. And we're going to see if it tells us something about God. Okay, here's the treasure chest back. And inside, what is this? Who knows what this is?
A bracelet.
It's a bracelet, right? And bracelets are sometimes like a thing we can wear or put on us that reminds us of things, right? It makes us, oh, we check our watches, but time. Yes, sir?
Can I talk to somebody?
You want to talk to someone? Okay. And so, thank you. Okay, good. Okay, a bracelet is something that we can put on, and it gives us, it reminds us of things, or it gives us some kind of message. Our watches are used to help us watch time and track time. Bracelets can have different meanings for us, right? This one has something on it that makes this bracelet special, and I want to see if someone can tell me what's written on this bracelet. Can you read that?
Courage.
It says courage. So when would I might need this bracelet of courage to put on me? When could it help me?
During elections.
Okay. Woo! Okay, yes. It could be helpful during elections. I was trying to be a little more general than that and say, and thinking more like, this would be a great bracelet to have whenever things are a little bit scary or you're not sure. You're doing something you've never done before, or you want to learn to trust things and not be anxious about it. You could have a bracelet like this that you could look at it, and it says courage. And you think, yes, courage right now is what I need to trust. And to know that when it comes to God, that God wants me to have courage. and trust Him and not just think about what I can do, right? But think about what He can do. So think about this for a moment. Not everybody has a bracelet like this, but are there ways that you could have a reminder that tells you that you need to have courage and trust God? Well, we could do like our friend here. You could take time and talk to somebody, right, that could tell you that you need to trust God and be courageous, right? And if it's an election even, I could go to the point of finding ways that I remember that it's not just the election, it's what God's doing, right? And I can trust God. So I'm going to ask you to remember that God's giving you a bracelet of sorts in your heart and in your life that tells you that you can always trust Him and have courage, even in difficult, scary times, okay? Let's pray. God, thank You for the courage You give us to take this time here with You and with each other, and the courage that You also give us just in knowing that You're always there. It's in Your name that we pray. Amen. So this bracelet goes home with whoever brought the box, and then I have the treasure chest to go home with someone and come back. Or you can just take it away from me. Okay. All right. Thank you, guys. Thank you for being here.
Let's continue worshiping. Stand and sing.
Down into time and wrote the story of His love for everyone. He has filled our hearts with wonder so that we always remember You and I were made to worship. You and I are forgiven and free.
things that really honors God is when we take the time to acknowledge His presence and embrace it in a way that we find ourselves able to give Him our thanks and our praise for the blessings of life, and to give to Him and share with each other even the need for prayer and support with the challenges of life. And I think God stands ready right now, if we are, to hear the joys and celebrations that may lift up one another, but also the needs and the concerns that we can embrace with prayer. What would be your joys and concerns to share today? Yes. Okay, we have a new baby about to join us, and so we celebrate new life and this potential, but we ask God's guide and protection in this process. We will be joining you in prayer for that. Who wants to take that responsibility to be a known person to pray for this need? I see a girl. Okay, you're going to give that. All right, Melody, thank you. What other joy or concern do we have? Okay, Ashley needs our prayers after rollover accidents. She's got some recovery and some need there in her life to get back on her feet and back to life the way she needs with family and children. So who wants to join Christy in prayer for that? Right here? Okay, thank you. And we're all accountable to that prayer. I'm just asking for a lead. Yes, sir. Yes.
Well, he's unsupervised, so we definitely need to pray. Yes.
Okay, I have two prayer requests then. I have a prayer request for the travel needs, and then I have some kind of supervision, responsibility, accountability with that would be helpful. Yes. Just if you see smoke or something, let us know, okay? But seriously, spring break, lots of folks traveling, and among your family, we have others out there that we just want to pray for safe journey away where they're going and back home. So who wants to help lead the need there? Since it's your family that's causing most of this, we'll let you take it on, Robert. Other joys or concerns? Yes, sir. Yeah. Yeah. All right. Good. So we have a prayer concern mentioned now for a celebration of the health and gift we have in life, but also for those who have a need. Maybe they could find direction and help in getting that taken care of. Is that what I'm hearing? Okay. So who wants to join? What was your name again?
Tony.
Tony. I'm not going to try the last name again. Yeah. Tony. All right. So I have someone helping with that prayer too. Thank you. Okay. Okay, he acknowledges you as friend. That's good. a joy. Yes, a joy for Otis's friend. No, that wasn't the way you were saying it. Yes, a celebration of that. Other joys or concerns? Right, and ultimately that does. The support of this concession with the schools and the time and investment that everybody puts into it, it leads to eventually offering scholarships and helping out some kids that could use that. So I celebrate with you. We have a joy for a good weekend where our folks helping with the concessions and everything were actually able to reach some of their goals for the year after some concerns, and they're ready to offer some scholarships and help and support. So who wants to join in that prayer of thanksgiving? Christine, okay. All right.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah. You add a little twist to it, but that's okay. That'll work. Christine. Yes. You were able to give honor and appreciation that was needed and still will. So I guess lift that prayer request up as kind of a background for us also to think about those that are sacrificing and risking in support of so many other needs that are out there, and a reminder of our commitments to support and pray for them. So a prayer for someone who is a responder and those who are letting go as a family connection with him. Who would take that prayer concern and be willing to lift? Thank you, bud. And I'm going to mention this morning we have a flower here that's given today in celebration of a lot of the families that we know right now are hurting over loss of loved ones here in the last few years perhaps. And we're mindful of that here as a church, and we're celebrating the new life also. So if you encounter some folks in our church that are in an anniversary time of a loss of a loved one, this is a time to let them know your church is hearing you. So we have a prayer concern there, and we pray for those who are dealing with the loss of loved ones. Would someone be willing to take that? Thank you. Right here. Okay. Let's join our hearts and spirits in prayer. God, we come to you in the knowledge that you have already listened in our conversation. You have felt and sensed our joy and celebration of where your love has prevailed and been revealed. But in the same moment, God, you've also sensed and seen us struggle with putting to words sometimes the needs of our lives, the pain of our lives, the places where we need to let you in and not try to do it on our own, and the uncertainties and the fears that we live with. All these are things that you stand ready and willing to take on and to become a part of joining us in those efforts. And Lord, I just pray that in these moments we understand the source of love and grace that we have in you, and the ways that we have a strength well beyond our own abilities in you. And I pray for the unspoken needs that are in this room also. Maybe a few hearts in this room also are stirring with concerns and anxiousness, but we know, God, that you're in control. And we know, God, that you have a plan, and we trust you for that. And like our children's message told us, Lord, we need to have courage because we always have you. And I pray for a family this morning that's preparing for a new life, a new addition, that you will see that in its completion, and you will bring forth a life that will make a difference in this world. I thank you again, God, for the love that you give us and for the love that you pour out for us. and the availability that you make whenever we can't do it on our own. Lord, if we could find the way in our heart and spirits today to draw upon you in a way that we know that the words we speak are more for us than you, and that the reminder of Christ and his prayer is a way that we can claim again this relationship that we have, then the words that Jesus taught us can speak to us as well as be from us. And so we remember and we say together the words that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. From the richness of God's grace, we find a means of response, that is to give for the sake of God and his kingdom. And the offering that we do in our worship is not meant to do anything more than remind us of how rich we are and how we are partners with Christ, even when we give, of any means at all. So I would ask for those who are going to help me with the offering this morning to join me, and let us pray. God, we thank you for this gift that we have in each other and the resources of life itself. You have blessed us far beyond our need, but it was your purpose then also that because of our richness, we are no longer exempt from responding to that love. So we give of ourselves, if nothing else, and we give in a spirit that says, Lord, take and receive that which we make, even the smallest of gifts, and create the greater miracles of your love. In your name we pray. Amen. It's already been won. I want to turn our attention to God's Word today. In the Gospel of Luke, we find a passage that speaks to our lives and gives us a chance to see a glimpse of discipleship. Although it's not the segment that always is the attractive one, it's still a part of what it means to be a disciple. That's all right. As they were walking along a road, a man said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." But Jesus replied, "Foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." He said to another man, "Follow me." But he replied, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." And Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Still another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family." And Jesus replied, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The truth is, it's not a glamorous passage of Scripture because it makes us feel a little bit uncomfortable. Jesus seems to have an edge to him, you know? And that's a little bit uncomfortable. We want the smiling Jesus, don't we? And we want our life of discipleship to be something bold and beautiful, but not something that's challenging and costly. And I got to be honest with you, it'll be hard for us to walk through this season of Lent on a journey of growth in our spirit to get to the cross and the meaning of the cross and beyond that to the celebration of Easter without a little bit of an uncomfortable thing happening along the way. And today's the day that we kind of start seeing some of this surface. I've been talking to you about you're a vessel of God and how God has designed and made you for his purpose. And now we're turning into that spirit of Lent that will walk us into believing that we are really also vessels for growth. God has a plan in your life to grow something new in you. And there's a cost to that process. Flashback, 1990, I think it was. Working as a youth minister, I had grown a youth program that was beginning to catch attention. Even that downtown church, Melvin Methodist, I think it is, was feeling pressure from the Pollard Church and its youth program. And so I was so proud of this, and it kind of started catching attention. The next thing I know, I'm being asked to serve and be a part of our conference youth council committee and help design and plan and implement youth ministries across the conference. Along with that, I brought along some youth who were good leaders in my youth program to bring them onto the table and part of this. And then around 1990, I got asked to attend and participate in the jurisdictional youth ministry elements of youth ministry, which was now going from just a Texas conference to 9 different states and a larger capacity, and what an honor. And so I made the arrangements to attend the week-long training and participation that I would do with a jurisdictional conference. And along the way, I brought a youth with me. And I remember I got up Sunday morning and loaded my car and started loading everything up and making sure I drove into Tyler to pick up my youth. We put all of his stuff in the car and we made our journey up to Texarkana, where we met with other youth and adults who were part of our representation from the Texas Annual Conference. And it was there that we're kind of scrambling around who's going to ride with who and whose stuff goes with who that I discovered I had not a single item with me. Nothing. I had no suitcase. I had no clothes. I had nothing. And I'm scratching my head and going, I know I took all these things to the car. Why was, you know, did someone steal stuff out of my car? Or did I set it out to load other things? I could not remember. So we didn't have the cell phones rampant then, so I had to borrow a phone at this parsonage, and I make a phone call home. Now, I'm in Texarkana. I live in Chandler at this point. So I make a phone call, and the phone is answered, and I can't get a word in for the laughter that I'm hearing on the other end, okay? It's just like laughter, laughter, laughter. Finally, with laughing words, I hear, "We were all wondering how long it would take you to make this phone call." And then they painted this picture for me. I'm looking out the window right now, the breakfast room, and there's a suitcase, a sleeping bag, a pillow, and some other bags sitting right there at the end of the driveway where you put them. And here I was in Texarkana. It was a time in my life that I found myself going, okay, how am I going to do this? Let's see, I could send everybody off. I could drive back to the house and get my stuff and then try to catch them all. And we were heading to Fayetteville, Arkansas, to Mount Sequoia Methodist Assembly. And I'm trying to figure out how I can justify being gone from everybody for about 4 hours. That wasn't going to work. So finally, I had to just face the fact I have no choice but to go forward. This is not a time that I get to go backwards. Now, the good news that I want to give you peace about this is that Fayetteville, Arkansas happens to be the hub and beginning of Walmart stores. So I found my peace. I got a full brand new wardrobe that week at Walmart. But my point is this: life gives us those circumstances where we realize that going backwards is not the way we need to be going. We're designed and made for going forward at this point, and it's not really an option to go backwards. But in this life of discipleship, also, we find that it's our tendency sometimes to kind of bring in, especially when we're faced with change or taking a new step of faith, that's the point that we want to kind of go back to the comfortable for a little bit and make sure, right? And we stall and we do everything else we can to keep from moving forward. Well, today, as a vessel of growth, I got some news for you. You're not going to grow much unless you're willing to break some ground. And that's not always an easy thing to do, because it means that we're making a sacrifice and we're going forward with something, and you really can't be looking backwards when you do that. Now, it's a joy for me that Melody's here, because she's a friend of mine growing up, and it's her dad that was the pastor for me that nurtured me into field ministry. Let me just put it that way. Well, he had this farm that he eventually hired me to help out with, and my job was year-round. It was, you know, plant corn, fertilize corn, grow the corn, pull the corn, then grind the corn and bag the corn, feed the cows, okay? And then when you weren't doing all that, there was an offsetting process where you made sure that the fields were mowed and cleared, okay, brush hog, take care of the pastures, and then you came along and you let it grow in a certain way that you then could cut, rake, and bale hay, load the hay, store the hay, feed the cows. The cows had it great, okay? But I was working my tail off every day. And it became a wonderful thing for me when it became brush hog season, because that meant all I really had to do was go out there and drive the tractor and cut the ground, right? And cut the weeds and stuff. And it was neat to see the changes of how things looked because of my efforts. And I got to tell you, I'd mowed yards earlier, and so I kind of migrated now to being able to brush hog on a tractor. But let me give you the picture of this first, okay? The tractor that I was allowed to use, there were two of them, and the nice Ford one was not the one that I got to use. The one I use was a 1929 model, okay, John Deere tractor, that had the front wheels in this early design, the 20s, was to bring the front wheels together in the front end of it and the back wheels wider on the back axle. So here I am in this 1929 tractor with a brush hog. But that's not all. What you also need to know is that, and I learned this from the ground up here, but this tractor had no first gear. So when you're starting your journey to brush hog, you have to learn the skill of slowly letting out the clutch and accelerating giving the gas so that you made sure you had the proper balance, so that not if, but when is what the point is here. Because with no first gear, the first thing that's going to happen is the front end of that tractor is coming off of the ground. And you have to be sure to skill the process enough that you can ride that thing back down to the ground and begin your journey, okay? So if you stopped, you knew, here we go again. Raise up. Okay, now we can go. And you didn't want to stop after that. You just want to go and mow and mow and mow until you run out of gas or something. And so I've learned all this process. I'm getting skilled at mowing. And one of the things that happens is you get kind of proud of yourself because here I am a perfectionist anyway, right? So I'm going along and I'm looking at, I'm thinking, I am cutting the most beautiful straight line in this pasture right now. That people should come and see this. That I'm, it's just beautiful. There's no gadget. I mean, it's gorgeous. And I would get so proud of myself in this process, manipulating that tractor just right with all the different challenges there were. Nonetheless, I had this beautifully cut pasture taking place. And then there's that temptation just to look at it and see it from behind. You know, just very carefully look. And, oh, it's gorgeous. And then you turn around, and guess what? You've gone off track now. You cut a wedge into your pasture that you have to come back now and chase down this little blade of grass that's there because you missed it. And I'm one of those people that I make the full circle, and I make it around until I come back and get that one piece of grass, and then I have to fix the edges that I messed up on the line. It's going to be another long process. And then after a while, that temptation hits again. Man, I'm doing a good job. But you learn. You can't look back once you've started. And Jesus is painting this picture here when he finally sums it up. They've been bringing to him their reasons why we need to do this, not today, maybe a little bit later. Give me just a little bit of time, Jesus. Let me tell you, I want to follow you. I do. I want to grow something here in this faith, but I need this first. Give me just. And Jesus is finally drawing the line in the sand and saying, the discipleship I'm calling you to is not an if and when. It's God's timing. And the truth is, you can't begin to plow and start looking backwards at this point. And that finally hits home for them, I think, where they begin to understand that this discipleship means I have to remember to face forward. God's growing something. He's creating something new, and that means the ground I'm on is going to be broken, the worlds I'm in going to be turned up a little bit, it's going to look a little different, and that's the cost. That's the cost of discipleship. If you study this passage, you find that before this, Jesus has been feeding the 5,000. He's been healing people right and left, and the crowds are getting so excited and enthused with this. Everybody wants to follow Jesus. You need to know that. The t-shirts, the I'm with him thing is really big right now because it's a popular thing. Your social status jumps if you're with this guy because he can bring it. But Scripture also tells us that at this point, Jesus has twice now began to speak to them about the fact that he will suffer death, and they haven't heard it. He's even using a phrase here called Son of Man, referring to himself, which is a new phrasing in this life he's had with them, because Son of Man refers not just to him personally, but who he is to become when he fulfills the will of God. And they're not catching it. So while they're saying to him, I want to follow you, I want to be a disciple, he is trying to explain to them, you need to know, my face, my focus is on the cross right now. And that's what you're talking about. Not just being my buddy, you're talking about walking with me to the cross. Some dirt is going to be turned. Some ground is going to be broken for that cross. So he starts speaking truth to them. Once you plow, you have to go forward. Once the ground is broken, we're going somewhere in this. I was at a UM Army camp, and it was one of those long days, late nights, where they're having a worship service at 11 o'clock at night, and as an adult, my body's not made for that anymore, but I'm trying to be faithful and diligent, so I did what probably a lot of you should be doing today, because I know you're tired. But I got my Bible, I started thumbing through my Bible like I was really studying something, you know, and everything. At least I'm engaged and they can't say I'm asleep, right? So I was kind of thumbing through and looking at scriptures, and I was just kind of picking scriptures and reading it. Flip a little bit, read this scripture. Flip a little bit, read this scripture. And I stumbled upon a scripture that has stuck with me ever since. The Gospel of John, chapter 6, verse 66. Go ahead, get your Bible, grab one in the pew in front of you if you want to, and pull it up. John 6:66. You won't forget that one, will you? John 6:66. Trivial thing that I stumbled across this. But and then I need someone bold enough to read it out loud for me so we can all hear it. You want to do that? She raised her hand. Does she even have her Bible open yet? She's so enthusiastic. I love you, Joe. Cell phones. We have all kinds of means here. John chapter 6, verse 66. Who has it and who will read it for me? I got all day. Okay. Okay, cool. That's okay. After this, say it again.
Many of his disciples drew back and no longer went about with
him. Many of his disciples drew back or went back and no longer could follow him. You know, I hit that, John 6:66, I'm like, wow. And then it's an impact verse. I'm like, okay, now I got to know the rest of the story, right? I got to know what's happened. Disciples are deciding they can't do this. Oh, I want to follow you, but no, I can't do that. What's causing that change? And if you look at this, what you see is that just before this passage, Jesus is actually saying to them, here's the hard part of being a disciple. And he starts spelling out the real life of discipleship to them, much like he is in today's passage. And the scripture tells us that at some point they were saying to themselves, this is too hard. This is just too hard. This is not what I got into this for. I'm sorry. Can't do this. And they quit following him. Now, I'm not pointing fingers or anything like that, but this still happens today in a lot of churches. It gets a little harder to be a disciple. It's a little harder, a little more challenging. I'll find some other place. I'll go somewhere else. I'll do this differently. I'll do it my way. And it's a sad truth that happens in discipleship. But sometimes the life of discipleship becomes so hard that it becomes difficult for people to find the measure of commitment that they need because grounds are being broken. And it feels a lot different when that happens. Now, the interesting thing about this passage also is that right after this, you know, Jesus had hundreds of disciples. So, you know, a few of them get discontented and leave, you know, whatever. But Jesus then turns to the 12 and he goes, how about you guys? Are you in or you're out? Let's go ahead and let's be real about this. Can you do this? And their answer is still a little bit, it's not a faithful, yes, we'll do it, you know. Instead, it's kind of like, well, what else are we going to do? We've given up everything. You're all we got. No turning back now. I don't know. To me, it's so much of the human nature in there too. But the truth is, it's another example where discipleship becomes harder as we move closer to the cross. And I'm going to tell you something. God does, he has created you as his vessel. He's put a signature of love in your life, and he has a plan. He has a dream. And he really wants to grow something in each of us. But it's going to take a commitment from us to let God break a little ground to see something new happen. Otherwise, you get the same thing. Oh, I know, there's a few people that could tell a witness today that I stepped out the back door, I threw watermelon seeds out there just to get rid of them, and lo and behold, a watermelon grew. Every now and then that might happen. But that's not God's plan. God's plan is to break a little ground and begin something new in each of us. And we've got to accept the fact that this life of discipleship, this commitment means I'm willing to let him stir a little dirt. So our beautiful altar scape today reminds us of how God's going to have to do a little work in our lives. And things are fixing to get a little difficult here and there. That there will be times in which he's going to need to He's going to need to scrape and turn and chisel away and remove the debris and make us ready for growing. That's the blessing of this, though. God's not out just to break ground. It's just a means to the grace that he wants to give us of growing something new in our life. I pray that today that doesn't scare you away. I pray, like our children's message, you're feeling a little bit of courage right now about the fact that you not only have the potter of your life who has shaped you and made you for his purpose, but you have the gardener of life itself that can grow something that no one has ever witnessed before in your life. Something brand new, something whole, something complete. And we need the courage to mean it when we say it. Jesus, I want to follow you. I know it's going to be difficult. I know it's scary to me, maybe. But I trust that you're the gardener. That trust that you're the one that knows breaking ground gets me to where I need to be. I say this to me as well as to you. I hope you hear that. Because there's not a one of us that doesn't find ourselves in that place. It would be much more easier just to use what we have and to keep things the way they are. But in the back of our minds, we keep wondering why the church isn't changing. Why my life isn't feeling stimulated and nurtured the way it used to be. And it's discipleship and it's spiritual experiences. I'm feeling dry. I'm feeling empty. And the truth is, we need to break a little ground. So I want to give you this invitation in this word today to let God this week in your life break ground, stir some dirt, make some things different in you. Trust in your commitment that he is growing something in those efforts. I believe this. I believe it will never happen. This breaking ground in our lives would never happen without a degree of love and possibility and hope that God sees on the other part of this. He's not going to do it just for the sake of watching us struggle. So, you are a vessel for growth. And very much the difference in what God will grow in you this season of Lent as you journey to the cross and beyond that into the glory of Easter will depend upon your courage today to let him stir a little dirt and begin the process. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. We're going to sing a closing song, and with it comes an invitation to you to let those words that we sing become a part of your expression. Are you trusting God today? Are you following his direction as a disciple? Are you committed in the way that even takes on the challenges of what it means to be a Christian? And do you really want to see something different in your life this Lenten season? Because God wants to grow a garden in your spirit. Will you stand and let us sing together? If you're needing a response to his word today from your heart, I want to give you the options here. You can come right down here to this kneeling rail. That's what it's here for. It's why we build these things. And you can have a time of prayer. You can ask someone to pray with you if you want. It's all here available to you. And at the same time, God's Spirit will come to you and just yield to him that these words become your words. Let us sing.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. How I need you. Yes, where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
It's a step forward when we can have the courage to let God do His work. And I'm thankful for the steps you may have made today in your spirit to trust Him, to break a little ground and create in you a new thing. May you go in God's grace and peace, and may the future be bright as you see again that God is your lead. Amen.